You write that this crisis was a policy failure, mainly with regard to regulation or deregulation, an intellectual failure because of the economics profession taking itself and its mathematics too seriously, and a moral failure. Briefly, what do you mean by that?
Well, by a moral failure, I mean that there was never, we lost the ability to look at economic life from a moral standpoint and ask, are we just too obsessed with increasing wealth? Are we too obsessed with just getting richer? Are we sacrificing all other aspects of life to efficiency as a goal?
Because love of money, you
love
write
of money.
About.
Because economists love efficiency. I mean, economics is about efficiency, really, getting the most for the least. And they think everything really ought to be sacrificed to that. As economists, but we've lost an independent moral standpoint in which we say, look, what is well-being? Is well-being the same as just increasing GDP per capita? Is that the same as well-being? Are they equivalent terms? And I think these moral issues are not cause. I mean, it's not that the crisis was a crisis of morality, but when you have a crisis of this kind, moral questions like this come to the fore, and rightly so.
So you don't know the comic book Scrooge McDuck, do you?
No,
Uncle Scrooge, who swims in money and he saves. This was the ultimate anti-Keynesian character, is it fair to say? Scrooge McDuck?
Yeah. I don't know.
Because he loves money and he never spends it, right?
But Keynes used to use Midas. You know King Midas, the old fable?
Yeah.
Everything turned to gold and they all starved to death because the food turned to gold as well. I mean, again, the paradox of greed, that if you're too greedy, you get poorer. And I think in moral terms, if people are too wealthy, if a society is too wealthy and it's obsessed with making money at the expense of leading a good life, a good, decent, and agreeable life, it's wrong. It's got its values wrong somehow.
And that's the essence of the moral Keynes.
That's the essence of the moral Keynes, yeah.
Well, I couldn't agree more with the observation that life isn't about getting more things and more toys. I like to say, I don't know who said it, but economics is the study of how to get the most out of life. Not make the most money, not get the most wealth, not be the most efficient in the stock market, but how to get the most out of life. It's about trade-offs. I think the tradition of economics that best embodies that is the tradition of Adam Smith. Not the tradition of Adam Smith and the Wealth of Nations, but the full Adam Smith. He wrote The Wealth of Nations, but his first book was The Theory of Moral Sentiments. And in there he said, man wants to be loved and he wants to be lovely, meaning he wants to be a decent human being. We fail sometimes, but economics at its core is about the human enterprise. And there I think Lord Skidelsky and I agree very much. It's not about materialism, although it counts, especially if you're starving to death and you don't have access to clean food, clean water, and you don't have food and clothing and shelter, materialism is rather important. But in the developed nations, we are gifted, we are blessed to have the opportunity to do things other than count our dollars and pour over our balance sheets. We're very lucky. And that's the essence of the meaningful life. And that's, to me, the essence of economics properly understood. So I think there, Keynes was very much in the footsteps of Adam Smith, again, properly defined to include Adam Smith's great work, The Theory of Moral Sentiments.
Well, I think Adam Smith was the economist that he most admired in the past, as well as Malthus. But Adam Smith was, I think, and I think that's true. I think most of economics after Adam Smith was a waste of time, actually.
I have one other question, which is inequality. Some people are pointing to that as part of the crisis here. Stagnant wages, people had to borrow to keep up their consumption level, people who were making money in the growth of the economy, a small fraction of the total, then loaned the money to the people who had to borrow. Do you think Keynes would have thought that that was a big part of the story? Because he did in the 30s,
yeah,
right?
I think he would, actually. I think he would have said that an economy in which wealth and incomes are more evenly distributed is easier to keep stable because you have this steady, broad demand coming through. It's not skewed into either indebted demand or speculation. And I think there was actually quite an investment dearth in the United States in the years leading up to the crash, which was disguised by buying existing assets and bidding up their
prices.
Well,
investing in housing or condominiums and so forth.
And I think in the actual, what used to be thought of as steady investment actually was very, very, very flat. And I think a very worrying thing, certainly in the UK, is investment has gone down by 18% in the last year. And where is the engine of the economy, what I call the sober engine, the engine for the long haul, going to come from? And that worries me now. And I think the inequality, growth inequality, has had quite a lot to do with that.
What do you think of that?
Well, two things. I think that a lot of the concern about inequality was based on a misreading of the data. I think the average person in America in the period that people typically talk about, the late 70s through 2006, say, the average person did quite well. The common view is that the rich got all the gains, the average person either stagnated or fell behind. If you look at panel data that follows people over time, you see that, in fact, people did do much better. Unfortunately, when we look at slices of people at times, we can get a very misleading picture. The other point I would make is that there's two sources of inequality that we ought to distinguish between. The people on Wall Street who made an enormous amount of money, basically spending my money and yours, that was reprehensible, and I hope we can find a way to stop that. My preferred way to stop that is through not bailing out losers, which I think we've made a huge mistake. But the second source is the genuine innovations of people like Steve Jobs, Sergey Brin, and Larry Page, who started Google, Steve Jobs of Apple. They accumulated large amounts of money through producing extraordinarily pleasant products that have made our lives nicer. And most of the benefits of those products, although they got very wealthy, Google makes my life better, my iPod makes my life better, and they got wealthy because they made other people happy. They made other people's lives better off. People on Wall Street made other people's lives, unfortunately, worse off, and they still profited. That is not good capitalism.
It's the parasitic face of capitalism.
Exactly.
I'd agree with what you said.
Lord Skidelsky, Russ Roberts, thank you both very much.
It's good to be here.
Very enjoyable.